Hello everybody, I'm Daniel, DJ LSB Vapes. Today, let's take a look on the Sigelli 213. Or may I say 155? Whatever. One thing I know, custard de leche from a Dory liquid is actually what she promises. And here is the Sigelli 213 in its box. Here on this side we have a hologram and a scratch code to check for authenticity. And on the back we have Sigelli 213 temp control. We have all the specs and a few warnings. Inside of this box we get a warranty card. We also get the Sigelli 213 user manual. And then we also get the same instructions in French, what appears to be Russian and Chinese. We also get an instructions manual on how to verify the authenticity code. And then inside of the box we get the Sigelli 213 itself. This one is the black version. We also get this tiny box that inside has the micro USB charging cable, or what it looks like. It's a very, very thin cable. And here is the Sigelli 213. It's actually quite light mod. The weight of this one is 132 grams, 224 grams with two batteries, of course, because this one is going to take two batteries. This one is rounded on all the edges, but it is going to measure 42.7 millimeters on this section here, but then on this section is a little bit bulkier. On this section we are looking to 43.6 millimeters by 29.1 millimeters, and it is going to be 88.6 millimeters tall. Here on top we have what appears to be an amazing stainless steel 510 connector with a spring-loaded positive center pin that actually has a lot of travel. On this side we have the mod all around is made with this kind of carbon wrap. It is a carbon look, but it will be definitely a wrap. Here you can see some inconsistencies on this wrap. On this side we have the control screen, the up and down buttons, very very clicky and not mushy at all, and they protrude just a little bit, but they are kind of buried inside of this section here. On this side we get the micro USB port and the fire button. The fire button on this one is really really clicky, definitely not mushy at all, and it almost doesn't protrude. It protrudes just a nail from the device, and it is actually, it looks easy to find. On this side we have nothing. Nothing on this side. And on the bottom we have the battery door with a ventilation slot or ventilation opening. And to open this battery door you just need to slide it and then you can open the battery door. This one is going to do battery charging, and from this gold-plated pin we have here a spring-loaded pin that is going to make contact with this entire plate that is closing the circuit, the series configuration circuit. So this mod is going to take two 18650 batteries and they are going to be in series, but we have this gold-plated spring-loaded contact here making connection with this plate, so I'm pretty sure this one has battery, good battery charging, balanced charging, but I'm gonna be checking that of course. And here we have what appears to be a serial number. Here we have the battery compartment, and the battery contacts inside are going to be spring-loaded, and the only indication of the battery's orientation is on the battery door. So I will strongly recommend you to use high drain batteries. Those are actually Sony VTC4 batteries. And of course on this side we are looking to the positive side of the battery up, and on this side the negative side of the battery up, just like that. Then you just need to close the battery door and slide it. There you go, it comes right on. Again, just like any EHI board, the Sigelli is going to be the same. If you hold the fire button when you close the battery compartment, you are gonna have the name of the chip and the version. And there you go, the device is ready to work. Here is the Sigelli 213 or 155, anyway, right next to the Sigelli Futshai 200 or 160. Anyway, really, really small device compared to the Futshai. Here is the Smok HPRIV, and this one is advertised as being a 220 watts device, and it actually gets really close to the 220. Okay, Sigelli, put your eyes on this one and another ones out there that do what they promise. Here is the Yihi SX Mini Q Class. Here is the Cooper Cheese Grater, the Cooper Primus 300 watts. Here is the SMY SDNA 200. Here is the IPv5. And here is the Joytech U-Boy. So let's check how the Sigelli 213 works, or may I say 155? Well, let's move forward. Here is the battery compartment again, and placing the batteries on the device. Again, I will strongly recommend you high drain batteries, and I'm using Sony VTC4 batteries on this one. On this side, positive, facing this contact. On this side, negative, facing this contact. And if you hold the fire button when you close the battery door, you have access to the chip name and the version. This is going to be the regular power mode screen. Basically, you have two different modes, a temp control mode and the power mode. This is the power mode. On the power mode, you can adjust the watts. Here is the selected wattage. Well, it doesn't actually do 213, but anyway, let's move forward. Here you have watts, and then you have the attached resistance, the applied voltage, and the drained amperage, or the calculated amperage for the selected wattage, the applied voltage for the attached resistance. On this side, you will always gonna have the voltage remaining on each one of the batteries inside, also the battery percentage, the entire series pack percentage, and the battery bar. To lock the device, 5 clicks of the fire button. And on the locking screen, you also have the battery bar and the battery percentage. To unlock, 5 clicks of the fire button. If you want to lock the power or the temp control adjustability, you hold down and fire buttons. Now you can still fire the device, but you can no longer adjust the device. Those up and down buttons will be locked. To unlock, you hold down and fire button again, and there you go. On power mode, you can adjust this one from 213 watts, sort of, all the way down to in 1 watt increments, and then once you go below 100 watts, in 0.1 watts increments or decrements, all the way down to 10 watts. This is the regular power mode. To do temp control on this device, you go into the menu, 4 clicks with the on the fire button, and then you have the power mode, and you have all the different temp control profiles. Okay, so for instance, if I want to do temp control on stainless steel, I select stainless steel, and then I select the grade of stainless steel I intend to use. For instances, in my case, 316. I select 316, then I can select if I want to make the adjustment in degrees Fahrenheit or degrees Celsius. I click the fire button again, and I'm on temp control. On temp control mode, you are gonna adjust in temperature, of course in degrees Celsius or Fahrenheit. You have the material you selected to do temp control, you still have the attached resistance, the applied voltage, and now the applied power to the selected temperature and the current temperature on the atomizer, well, if the device was actually doing a great job. But anyway, the approximate wattage it is going to, or it is supposed to be applying to maintain that temperature, then here we have the same information. Now, on temp control, for instance, if I attach a stainless steel coil, on temp control, I will strongly recommend you to, every time you attach a new coil, you attach your atomizer and your coil, and then I'm gonna strongly recommend you to hold up and down buttons together and then select read the resistance. There you go. Now, once it reads the resistance, to do a better temp control, I'm gonna recommend you again, or I'm gonna recommend you to hold up and down buttons again and then select lock. The resistance will be, well, is supposed to be locked. I don't feel it is locked by any means, but that's another issue. And here is an example. I'm gonna put the device, I'm actually going to do this example with their own bullshit TCR they have on their website for stainless steel. So, there you go. I'm gonna attach a 316 stainless steel coil. I'm gonna read the resistance and I'm gonna lock the resistance. Let's run a piece of cotton through this coil and let's fire it. First time is okay. Second time is a little bit hotter. As you can see, we have some smoke coming from the cotton. Now, the third and the fourth and the fifth times I fire it, it is going to be hotter and hotter and hotter, and eventually is going to burn the cotton. There you go. Of course, I'm at 500 degrees Fahrenheit because I didn't notice, but I'm gonna run it again at 400. It's going to be exactly the same. It doesn't make much of a difference. Now, it is going to be basically the same. There you go. 400 or 500 is basically the same. Yeah. There you go. But anyway, I still recommend you to lock the resistance, okay? If you want to adjust the power, the amount of power you want to have available here, by the way, once you fire, you have the power being applied in real time. If you want to select the amount of power you want to have available when you press the fire button, only works on temp control mode. You hold up and fire buttons, and then you adjust how many watts you want to have available when you press the fire button, and then you press fire, and then you can also select how many seconds you want to have the preheat. So you can also adjust a preheat from 0.01 seconds all the way up to 9.99 seconds. Okay, so what does that mean? It means that you are gonna have a pre-punch or a pre-hit as long as the amount of time you select in here. For example, if you want 1 second pre-hit every time you fire the device, you just select 1 second. There you go. That's the pre-hit option. Anyway, once it reaches the temperature on the screen, it is going to limit you. It's not doing a wonderful job limiting the temperature, but anyway, that's how it is supposed to work. It doesn't work how it is supposed to, but that's how it is supposed to work. On temp control, when you fire, of course, you have the power you selected that you want to have available right away. When you fire, once it reaches the temperature, it is all immediately going to drop you down in power to maintain the temperature you selected in here. Again, not accurate, but again, doing some sort of a temp control job. On temp control, here of course you adjust the temperature, and to adjust the temperature on this one in degrees Fahrenheit, you can adjust it from 200 degrees Fahrenheit in 5 degrees Fahrenheit increments all the way up to 570 degrees Fahrenheit. And if you select to adjust in Celsius, you can adjust this one from 300 degrees Celsius in 1 degree Celsius increments all the way down to 100 degrees Celsius. So that's how the temp control works on this amazing screen with a bunch of information. Now, if you want to do temp control on titanium, you just select titanium. If you want to do temp control on nickel, you just select nickel. If you want to do temp control in other different materials, you select TCR or TFR. TCR, if you know the TCR for the number you want to do, for the wire you want to do temp control, then you can store that TCR number in 5 different profiles. Now, Sigaleo also has on their website a TCR tool. I tested with the normal TCR for the wires I want to do temp control, and I tested with their TCR. In, of course, on this video you have access to both results, and I also tested for TFR. Anyway, for instance, if I want to do temp control on stainless steel, on 316L stainless steel with the Sigale inaccurate TCR, and I want to save it on the memory preset number 3, then I can adjust here the TCR I want to have in here. If I select the left button, I'm gonna scroll between the different numbers, and if I select if I use the up button, I'm gonna change the number on each one of those places. Once I hit the fire button, I'm gonna be doing temp control on this memory preset. But anyway, even with the Sigale bullshit TCR calculator, even with those presets, temp control is not going to be accurate still. Okay. Anyway, let's move forward. Then, of course, you also have TFR. TFR is, well, it's kind of the way Evolve tried to do temp control on the DNA200. Kind of the way you can do temp control on the DNA200, getting the CSV files from Steam Engine. Here is how you can obtain the TFR numbers.
Basically, you go on Steam Engine or steam-engine.org, and then on the Wire Wizard tab, then you can select single parallel twist. You can select the type of wire you are using. And for instance, if you are using a 316L stainless steel wire, now we have all the TFR numbers. I will recommend you to click in in table, and here are the values you are gonna set up on the device on each one of those temperatures in degrees Celsius. So the device is going to ask you the value for each one of those temperatures on the screen, and then you just set up those values for the wire you select here. For instance, if you are too fancy and if you want to do temp control on gold, here are the values.
Once you get the numbers for the wire you want to do temp control with TFR option, once you enter on the TFR option, anyway, those are all the options on the menus on the menu of this device. Once you enter on TFR, you also have 5 different presets. And then, for instance, I want to store the TFR for stainless steel, for example, on the memory preset number 3. Then I place those numbers you just seen on Steam Engine. I place the number for 100 degrees Celsius. Same exact thing, I scroll with the left button and I adjust each one of those numbers with the right button or up button anyway. Okay. And then here I place the number I just seen on Steam Engine for 150 degrees Celsius, here for 200 degrees Celsius, here for 250 degrees Celsius, and here for 300 degrees Celsius. Then I can also adjust or select if I want to adjust the temp control in degrees Fahrenheit or degrees Celsius. There you go. Now I'm doing temp control on with TFR technology, or anyway, TFR temp control on the memory preset number 3, and it is going to be exactly the same thing, exactly the same inaccuracy. Anyway, let's move forward. On any temp control profile, you have the same exact options. You can still hold up and down buttons, lock and unlock the resistance, or exit, or read the resistance, as I shown you before. You can also hold up and fire button and adjust your preheat, adjust the amount of watts you want to have available right away, adjust the preheat. If you don't want any preheat at all, you can, for example, select 0.01 seconds, for example. And there you go. That's the temp control on this mod. Of course, as you are going to see on this review, it's kind of a shame of a temp control, but anyway, I like the mod itself. I like the design. I love the build quality. I love the menu system. It is very easy and convenient, but still with a bunch of information on the screen. And I love this screen. Okay, love this device. I love this form factor. But it's a shame. Okay, it is really, really a shame. It has great potential, but it is a shame. By the way, one thing I do like on this mod is the charging capabilities. Okay, it does balance charging. Okay, and I like how fast it charges the batteries, because it charges the batteries pretty much at 2 amps. And you can also vape while charging. It's not pass-through, okay? It is not going to be pass-through, but vape while charging. Again, I'm going to explain the difference. So pass-through is going to be supposedly a device that when you fire is using the current or the amperage from the USB connection directly to the coil. Okay, there's no such thing these days as pass-through, because you don't have enough amperage on a USB connection or on a USB wall plug enough to fire the coils we use these days. Vape while charging is the device is going to be using the current coming from the USB connector, from the USB cable, to charge the batteries, as you can see here. But every time you fire the device, you are going to interrupt the charging and drain the batteries. Once you stop firing, it is going to stop draining the batteries and start charging them again. That's vape while charging. Pass-through is completely different, and we don't have pass-through these days. Okay? That's it, guys. Alright, so here is the Seagela 213 completely taken apart. Here is the housing. And as you can see, it is made of a piece of aluminum. And it looks like it is actually carbon fiber. And why do I say that? Because I tried to remove this layer, the black layer you see here, and it is a very, very thick layer, as you can see. This is not a sticker. So I will assume it is actually a carbon wrap around the aluminum. And then, of course, they polish the carbon piece, or the carbon layer. Okay, so it actually has a carbon finish around it. Now, if it is actually carbon or plastic, I don't know. But I actually had a little defect here on the bottom, and I tried to get it flush. I tried to remove the defective portion of this layer, and by the sound and how rigid it is, this is not plastic, definitely not plastic. So I will assume it is indeed carbon fiber. Again, it is going to be an aluminum housing, really light, and then inside we have a very good job. Inside we have a very thick black painting just for insulation purposes. So they actually care about safety, and they don't want anything to be shorting inside of this metal housing. So they have this very thick layer of black paint inside. Then here is the circuit board. This is the front side of the circuit board, and as you can see, just as IHI, Pioneer for You, and Sigelli in the past, they always scratch the surface of the components, so we can't see which components they actually use. Here we have the up and down buttons, OLED screen, just a standard OLED screen. On this side we have the back of the board, just a few components. We have the battery contacts, really good battery contacts directly soldered on the board. The solderings on this one are very good, very good job indeed. Okay, here we have the fire button, and then here we have the positive pin of the 510. So since it is a very small mod, this is a very genius thing they actually did. They actually were very intelligent designing this 510. By the way, the spring is going to lay on top of this portion. We have a third wire coming from here. To here. So the third wire is going to be for battery monitoring and also for balanced charging. There you go. Of course, the board is mounted on top of this plastic half of battery compartment. Is just half of the battery compartment. The rest of the battery compartment is actually going to be the mod itself, I think. Yes, the mod itself. Okay, the housing itself. Here is the up and down buttons, as well as the OLED screen and fire button and micro USB port and 510 housing. Here we have the negative side of the 510. Again, very good stainless steel 510 connection. And then here we have the spring-loaded positive center pin, okay, or positive contact. Everything is actually very well thought, very well designed. Here is the battery door. And here is the top part of this battery compartment that is going to make those contacts spring-loaded. Now, looking to the way this one was built, was designed, I was actually thinking we had firmware upgradability capabilities. Why? Because the data contacts on the micro USB port are actually soldered, and they actually have traces on the PCB. Now the thing is, the traces of the data contacts or the data connections between the micro USB port and the controller unit on this board, they actually end here. Why? Because then they go to the other side of the PCB. Then on the other side of the PCB, here are the contacts. So they come those two contacts come both from the other side. They are soldered to the micro USB charging port, and then those contacts have an end. Okay, then those contacts go from here to here, and they are incomplete. As you can see, they end here. The circuitry is incomplete, and that's why this one doesn't have firmware upgradability. I don't know why they did that. I don't know why they actually designed the board to have communication between the micro USB port and the controller unit, and then they ended up doing an incomplete board. I don't know why, but that's what they did. Okay, so we are missing here maybe probably some resistors, okay, to complete the circuitry. Let's reassemble everything. And there you go, the device is now back into place.
And here are the numbers, the readings, and the charts on the Sigelli 2 and 3, or may I say Sigelli 155. As you can see here, it has a very good step down. It maintains really well the 10 watts. Then at 60 watts, it starts to fire just a little bit higher, the 0.12 ohm resistance. The others are really accurate. Then here, of course, it fires below because we achieved the device voltage limitation. That is around 6.48 volts. At 110 watts, the same, fires a little bit higher. Just slightly higher, the 0.12 ohm coil, nothing major. Then it fires accurate, or pretty much, well, it fires actually below the 0.27 ohm coil. And then again, that we reach the device voltage limitation. At 160 watts, we have 149.8 watts. Then again, with a 0.27 ohm coil, we reach the device voltage limitation, and so on. At 213 watts, this is the maximum we get from this device. We get 155.5 watts. I could have tested resistances below 0.1, but the lowest reading or the lowest resistance this device is capable of firing is actually 0.1. So 0.11, 0.12, 0.10, around that I got the 155.5 watts. So I can say Sigelli 213 my ass. Okay, call it Sigelli 155. Here is the temp control on the nickel mode we have on the screen. And as you can see, single coil on the left, dual coil on the right, really, really inaccurate. And I'm going to tell you right now that I acquired those temperatures firing the device with every single coil only two times. Why only two times? Because here you can see that if I fire the first time, it basically controls the temperature below the temperature is set up on the screen is actually lower than the second time, or if you fire the device with the coil already a little bit hot because you are vaping that coil, you get a much higher temperature, and those temperatures are the temperatures I have on the screen, because those temperatures are actually the ones that you are gonna be able to have a decent vape. So most of the times when you press the fire button the first time, you have a very shitty vape and you need to press the fire button the second time. And then of course, as you can see on this video, if I press the third and the fourth and the fifth time, if I keep vaping, the temperatures are going to increase and increase and increase. I will assume that this device has resistance lock. If you hold both up and down buttons, you can lock the resistance, but it's not locking. The device is not locking any resistance at all. The device is, in fact, every time you fire the fire button or you click the fire button, the device is reading the resistance at that moment and firing depending on that resistance. That's why it is going to fire higher and higher and higher. So this is the nickel temp control on the nickel temp control profile. Here is the titanium temp control on the temp control profile, inaccurate. Here is the stainless steel temp control on the stainless steel temp control profile that we have on the menu, inaccurate. Here is the nickel temp control using their own Sigelli TCR calculator. The link for that bullshit calculator is going to be in the description if you are interested in that thing. But we, even with the Sigelli TCRs, here is the nickel temp control test, single coil on the left, dual coil on the right, still inaccurate. Here is the titanium test with their TCR values. And here is the 316L test with their TCR values. Now, I went further, and here is the nickel temp control with the TFR option. Here is the titanium temp control with the TFR numbers. Here is the stainless steel temp control with the TFR numbers. Everything inaccurate. This is not a good temp control at all. Okay, at all. And by the way, all those temp control tests were made with 0.01 preheat. Okay, basically no preheat at all. Then here is the signal. This device has a very straight, very flat DC signal, and it doesn't have heartbeat at all. What it has is when you press the fire button with no coil attached, it is going to try to fire. And then once it reads no resistance attached at all, then it slowly drops down. That's what this device does. Here is the firing delay and the firing delay on standby. The firing delay on the regular on the working screen, on the working mode, is going to be around 200 milliseconds. And here is the moment I press the fire button. We are going to have a peak, and I think it is the device reading the resistance. Okay, so the device reads the resistance every single time, even on temp control with the resistance locked. That's the issue. That's their flaw. This is an issue. I'm going to call this one an issue. Okay, this is a very poorly made firmware for this device. It should have been fixed and recalled This is my opinion, because even on temp control, every time I fire the device or you fire the device is going to read the resistance. On temp control, it shouldn't. On temp control, it should lock the resistance, even especially if you lock the resistance on the screen on the menu, should lock the resistance and should never read the resistance again when the coil is hot or wherever. Okay, so here is the moment I fire, then it has this peak, and then eventually is going to fire. If the device is in standby, if the screen is off, it does the same exact thing. Here the moment I fire, here the moment it fires this higher voltage just to read the resistance, and then eventually it's going to fire, but in standby mode we have a 233 milliseconds delay. Here is the temp control curve. Here the moment I fire, here I'm blowing on the coil, here I'm not blowing. On the right, the same exact coil, but with a cotton wick. Here, the moment I fire, here I'm dripping some juice, and then eventually the juice evaporates, and there it is. It's a very linear and very good temp control curve. It's a very good temp control signal. It's really a shame. Really a shame, the fact that the device has the poorly temp control it has. Here is the 510 connection measurings chart, and as you can see, this one here on top, you can see that it is pretty on par with the standard, it's not a standard, with the most common on devices. And here, as you can see on the bar, on the chart, it is actually on par with pretty much all the devices out there, okay? It's not one of the best, but still not one of the worst. And here are all the battery usage and charging measurings, and as you can see, this device is going to use both batteries down to 3.2 and the other 3.22 volts. So below 3.2 it is going to say battery low and you can't fire this device anymore. If you charge the batteries internally, the device is going to charge both up to 4.11 volts. And the charging rate, the charging speed on this one is 1.97 amps, pretty much 2 amps, and that's really amazing. That's it, guys. That's the possible review on this piece of shit. Well, it's not totally a piece of shit. It's actually a very comfortable and very well-built device, but everything else sucks. These days, with so many good devices out there, Sigelli putting out a $100 device like this, it is a shame. Let me start talking about another one, the Sigelli Foodshy. I got this one directly from a vendor. Okay, so it was a retail version, not a sample, not a beta version, not a prototype. And I tested, I did everything on it, I used it, and my complaint on this one was the fact that I wasn't getting more than 158, approximately 160 watts. And I was having a really, really awkward signal on the scope. I contacted Sigelli, and their answer was, you need to use 40 amp batteries. Well, there's no such thing as 40 amp 18650 batteries. And I told them, how the hell am I supposed to use or to choose 40 amp 18650 batteries if the maximum we have available is 30 amp batteries, 30 amp 18650 batteries? And then they replied me with an even worse message saying, well, you should use EFAST batteries because EFAST batteries are actually higher amperage. Well, we all know EFAST are rewraps of other brands, like for example LG, Samsung batteries, and there's no such thing as more than 30 amp batteries. And then I continued the discussion with them, and then eventually they told me, well, we think that you got one of the prototypes, or you got one of the bad batches, or one of the first batches that weren't supposed to be sold but are being sold. Well, a bunch of crap. They basically made a bunch of excuses, and I at the time I was getting so much devices to review, I didn't review this one. Then I was actually really excited with the Sigelli 213 because of the looks, the size, for a dual 18650 battery mod, the looks, all the functions. I was actually really excited. I started testing this one and I started finding all the bullshit on the firmware, on all the bullshit on this device. It doesn't do more than 155 watts. Well, don't get me wrong, I still love this device. I still love the form factor of this device, the build quality, the design, it's amazing. The entire device is amazing, but it sucks the fact that it doesn't do what they promise. And being Sigelli, also playing the same shitty game of calling 213, and not even 200, but 213 watts on a device that doesn't do more than 155, well, again, it is still a good device for me because I usually don't vape higher than 100, 120 watts anyway. But still, I need to do the proper job as a reviewer. I need to do my job as a reviewer. The device is advertised as 213 watts. It is advertised as temp control. And it doesn't go beyond 155. And temp control on this device? Forget it. I won't even call it temp control. Anyway, let's move forward with this piece of crap. Of course, they advertised this device and they started selling this device as being a firmware upgradable device. Then, as you can see on the close-up, on the disassembly portion of this video, there's no way of you getting any firmware or any upgrades inside of this device. It doesn't have firmware upgradability at all. Another thing, they made a huge excuse about they were actually doing the proper TCR and the proper temp control. All the other companies are doing it wrong. So they came up with the TCR tool on their website. The link is going to be in the description. I tried. I tested their own TCRs that are way too off. Their TCRs are basically half of what they were supposed to be. But I still tested their bullshit TCRs and exactly the same bullshit. Temp control, it's awkward. By the way, let's talk about temp control on this one. My measurings, my charts on the temp control on this one are always firing the device two times, okay? I always fire the device two times to get those temperatures because if I keep firing, it actually gets worse and worse and worse and worse and totally impossible to measure because the coil is gonna glow, my probe is gonna melt, and then I need to switch. By the way, every time my probe melts, as you can see, this one is the last one I used. It's still acceptable, but every time my probe melts, I basically switch the probe with the new one because I'm about consistency, and every time I burn a probe, I switch the probe with the new one, and I'm not here to burn 10 or 20 probes, okay? So those temperatures are, if you fire the device two times, or if you chain vape only for two times, you get those temperatures. If you keep chain vaping, you keep getting higher and higher temperatures. So I won't call this thing a temp control device at all. For a regular power mode, if you vape less than 155 watts and you like the looks of this device, yeah, sure, it's a good device. It's a very well-built device, but other than that, it's a shame. It's really, really a shame. Sorry for this cranky video, but it has to be. It has to be. It was the Food Chain, now the 213, or may I say 155, and they were asking for this. Now, well, with so many cons, let me finish the cons. And those are basically the cons I have on this device. The temp control inaccurate. Not doing more than 155 watts when they advertise 213. Not locking the resistance because I'm pretty sure the issue, the flaw, they may have nailed everything on it, but the flaw on this device is the fact that it doesn't lock the resistance. Even if you lock the resistance, as I explained on the close-up, it is not locking the resistance. Every time you fire the fire button, it has that peak you've seen on the signal, on the oscilloscope readings, on the oscilloscope signal. Every time you fire, even on temp control, it has that peak. It is going to read the resistance every time you fire the fire button. So if the resistance is already a little bit hotter, if it is not at room temperature anymore because you are actually vaping, it is going to read the resistance higher and then fire higher and higher and higher. My concern on this one is actually on nickel and titanium, not as much on stainless steel, because stainless steel you can actually use on regular power mode. So please don't use this device to vape on nickel, especially on nickel. Another huge con, of course, the fact that it doesn't have firmware upgradability, even when they advertised as being firmware upgradable in the beginning. Other than that, let's mention the pros and wrap this one up. The pros. I love the build quality. I love the form factor and the fact that it is actually a carbon wrap or a carbon finish around the aluminum housing. It's a very light device for a dual 18650 battery device. It's very comfortable. I would like to see a better fire button because since we have this metal thing protruding, sometimes it's actually really hard to find the fire button. So I'd like to see a better fire button. Is it easier to find? But it is not one of the worst fire buttons by any means. Okay, I like the looks. I like the build quality. I like how clicky the buttons are. I like the screen. I love this screen, and especially all the information we get on this screen. I love how they did the temp control, or how they intended to do the temp control, all those wires and then TCR and TFR for the most advanced vapors. I like how they did and how they thought things, but they weren't properly accomplished. I love the 510. I love the battery door. This battery door is amazing. It's very easy. I love the fact that I have absolutely no rattle at all, nothing flimsy on it. It's solid. It's a rock solid device, really well built, really well thought on the designs. But everything else sucks. That's it, guys. I don't have anything more on this one. I hope you enjoyed this video. Well, it was the possible review on this device. I don't do magic. If you enjoyed this review, please give me a thumbs up, subscribe my channel and my website djlsbvapes.com to get notified on the next videos and next giveaways, and I will see you on the next one.